Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Well, happy Palm Sunday. Glad to see you all. Glad to see the palms ready. You know, I finally figured it out. I always thought that, you know, this is, you know, a pretty thin version of what was probably waved when Jesus entered. But if we had the branches all together and each one of you had one and you started waving them, the trustees are meeting Tuesday night anyway, and the liability stuff would just be deadly. Welcome, and this is the beginning of the week of the year. Palm Sunday quickly becomes Maundy Thursday, Good Friday, and Easter Sunday. Lots going ahead with that, but just before I go on to the those events, just a reminder, we have our youth group that meets 6:30 on Sunday evening, a great group, and really they have like a midweek meeting too, under the disguise of homework help, but they go on with that. Kathy?
I believe they were meeting earlier to do a cleanup of the upper room. So
all right, check with Sarah on the timing on that. Thank you for their help on that. All righty. So, and what, I was afraid the cleanup might be for the Easter egg hunt, which is in the back lawn. Now, probably the grown-ups enjoy watching kids do Easter egg hunts as much as the kids do. And so if you want to do that, we're gonna progress right to that. After the service, and there's actually in two stages, the littlest ones on the back lawn, and then I think the older kids are doing one in the outdoor chapel. So just be glad they're not using raw eggs. So what's going on? Now this week is coming on. We had a great event yesterday for Christianity Explored. The folks at the Halifax Congregational Church were our hosts, and it was a very good time together, and they did a very nice job hosting us. Maundy Thursday, we have our special Seder Supper. Many of you signed up. There's going to be over 60 in attendance. A special treat. Come a little early because there's going to be a harpist playing. It harkens back to the bells playing before the Christmas Eve service. But there'll be a harpist. I'm figuring on 4:45. Who knows what time? But for that. That's Maundy Thursday. Good Friday. Between the Thursday and the Friday, we have a prayer vigil going on. Our deacon, Bob Wilcox, has as part of his personal devotional life, always spending the night in prayer here. And there are these prayer request cards. Where can they be gathered? Who's got that? Are they in your pews? Yep, okay. So if you've got a prayer request that you'd like to keep Bob busy with through the night, feel free to have him do that. But it's an important thing that we can be praying for one another. You can fill these out, hand them to him. Where are you, Bob? Wave your hand. There you are. Okay. I knew you're always there. Okay. Good Friday, 5 o'clock, chowder supper, 6 o'clock, a service of the gathering shadows, and it'll be a little more dim than dark shadows because it's a 6 p.m. service on a spring day. But we'll still have that impact of as we begin to feel a little bit of the betrayal of our Lord. Sunrise service. And I am glad for a sunrise on Easter because, you know, after you've endured our Lord was buried, you don't want to wait to celebrate that he's risen. And so gather, please, if you will, on the shores of Lake Monponset by the Lakeside Villa. And at 6 a.m., our own Sarah Marcolino will be bringing the morning message. It's a good one. And afterwards, you can enjoy breakfast at the 550 Tavern that is right there, and you can order off the menu there. I want to invite our moderator to call our attention to a congregational meeting.
Not next Sunday, but 2 weeks from today, following the worship service, there will be a congregational meeting. Been called at the request of the deacons. It's been posted by the clerk. It has been posted in the Narthex and Outback, I believe, and in our newsletter for the very brief but very joyous purpose of hearing recommendations from the deacons for new members for this church and voting thereon. That will be the only purpose of the meeting, so it will be brief. We can remain comfortably seated here unless you're not part of the meeting, but we look forward to seeing you all on April 24th at probably 11:01 a.m. Thank you.
Thank you. And if you're not a member, it's not a secret. You can feel free to just remain And as some of you have told me, how do you congregational Christians do things? So,
sure,
you can peek. The flowers are part of the Easter season, and there's information on how to order those as well. Your Lenten boxes, little opportunities for gifts for the special purpose of supporting Seafarer's Friends, our ministry to the crews of the many, many freight ships that circle our globe. There's a special little opportunity for them. Can we see that picture of the cross with the... come on, we got it. It's coming. I can hear it coming along the court. There we go. In the Fellowship Hall, there is you'll see a cross hollowed out, and there are little shelves within for you to place your boxes. So just a neat little thing this year. I think that's great. And I just also want to remind you, because I think a lot of this may happen for us during Holy Week, as you do your private time of prayer and study and just appreciating what God has done for us, take the time to prepare a little 300-word just story of what God's speaking to you about. We call them life lessons through Lent. We're going to create a devotional for next year out of what we all contribute. So member, guest, friend, in person, online, everyone welcome. Information there. If you don't get that information quickly, of course, one, you can go back to Facebook and look it up again. But otherwise, just contact us and we'll help you do that. But we look forward to having that celebrating of 40 and more devotionals that we can put together for next year's celebration on our 275th anniversary. Those are our announcements, and it is frees us now to focus our hearts on the purpose for which God made us, to praise Him. Let's stand together and sing first Forever, and then You Are My King.
God is faithful. Forever God God is with us forever. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us forever.
We're singing a lot about love today, and I just encourage you, every time that word love comes, just open up a little bit more and let a little more love in from the Lord.
Thank you. Good morning. Please join me in the call to worship. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me, from the words of my groaning?
Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night,
but find no rest.
Yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel.
All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations shall worship before him.
For dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations.
Welcome back, bells, and really nice. We have Bell Choir 1 and Bell Choir A. Or, because next week we get to hear the other one. Great. Please join me in prayer. Lord, we want to be those who throng the streets, waving palm branches and welcoming you on your triumphal entry to the New Jerusalem and also into our hearts. You are the God who loves us with an everlasting love. You see us through our danger times, our passion times. And you are victorious, and we love you for it, and we trust you for it. So when we go through our dark times, we want to be trusting and still obedient, though the night around us be storming, be gathering, be cloudy. We honor you as the God who is so good. We thank you for Steve's mom recovering well from surgery, for Mary Barber's nephew released from Children's Hospital and treatment going well. Grateful for folks back again. Grateful, Lord, for a time to celebrate all you've done and for the glad journey of Christianity explored and knowing that there's a journey for us through this Holy Week. Lord, and we are glad that we can turn to you with our prayers for those who are sick and in trouble. We ask your healing touch on Carl, on Pete, on Danielle, on Ruth, on that little preemie Pilar. We thank you for Janet's successful outpatient surgery. Pray for Ken Holmes from this church receiving radiation treatment for brain cancer. That would be healing. We thank you, God, that no matter what we face, you are there, and we ask that you might have your strength and blessing on those facing difficulties of every kind. We ask your comfort on the family and friends of our dear Bob Cox, who has passed. Lord, help us to honor you. Not only his memory, but especially your grace in his life when those services come after Easter. To grant to Billy Joe and her family safe travels as they come up from Virginia. And Lord, would you work peace in our world, especially in the troubled area of Ukraine? We pray for relief for those who are fleeing for their lives. We pray for an end to the conflict. An end to aggression, and your mercy on those seeking to help the struggling refugees. Help us, Lord, to discern your call on our lives individually and as a church. You have brought us through the stormy years of pandemic for a purpose. Help us to discern it and fulfill it. By your grace and strength. We thank you for those that you are drawing to this congregation from every corner. And we ask your blessing on those who might be watching now. That if the next step might be in person, the next step might be reaching out online to us. Lord, you're doing a new thing with video. And we pray that we might use the tool in a way that honors the Son of God who gave up all to come and be among us. We look, Lord, for you to be at work in our lives and for us to honor you with them. And so we pray together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We are grateful to be part of a body where we seek to respond to God's goodness with offering not only of finances, but of our talents, our treasure, our time. Thank you for those who've made gifts to the baskets in the back or online or by mail. Whatever way we have, please join me as we dedicate them in prayer. Lord, what we give, we only return a portion of what you've already given to us. We can't outgive you, because the only things we could give are what you've given. And that which we retain, either individually or as a church, would you grant that we use it in a way that honors you? Let there never be any misuse. And Lord, would you bless each person near and far impacted by these ministries? We especially pray this Sunday for seafarers' friends, that for those who might very well be lonely and tossed and turned on the sea as Jonah was, that they might find your comfort and see the strong and good hand of God at work upon the deep. Dedicate our gifts to you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and sing, "Oh, How He Loves You and Me."
Scripture reading this morning is from John 19, verses 25 through 37. And that is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there. So they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Since it was the day of preparation, the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because that Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified so that you also may believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occurred so that the scripture might be fulfilled. None of his bones shall be broken. And another, and again, another passage of scripture says, they will look on the one whom they have pierced. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Ellie. This ship has a Jonah. That's an expression. And I don't know if Captain Henry Starbuck, commander of the whaling vessel Daniel Webster, who retired to East Bridgewater in 1850, heard that. He came to East Bridgewater when the whaling trade evaporated. He was my great-great-great-grandfather. And I expect he, like most whaling captains, most ship's captains, had to deal with superstitious crews. Hence, this ship has a Jonah. I sometimes think my experience with summer camps drew from a skill set that I got from him. Groups of people who spend days and nights in close quarters, cut off from the rest of the world. They can get a little testy. Both groups can tend to focus the blame for their discontent on a scapegoat from within their own number. Calling that scapegoat a Jonah comes from the Old Testament story about that prophet whom God called from Israel to go and call the people of Nineveh to repent. They needed to change their ways. Jonah chose to disobey God. Not a wise career move. To evade God's call, he went to the coast and boarded a ship for a far-off country. God didn't let Jonah off so easily. God began to trouble the waters through which the ship was sailing. And the ship's crew was desperately afraid and wondered what had brought such sudden and severe trouble on them. That brings up our passage this morning, Jonah 1, 9 to 17. Jonah said, I am a Hebrew. I worship the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land. Then the men were more afraid and said to him, what is this that you have done? For the men knew that he was fleeing from the presence of the Lord, because he had told them so. Then they said to him, what shall we do to you that the sea may quiet down for us? For the sea was growing more and more tempestuous. He said to them, pick me up and throw me into the sea. Then the sea will quiet down for you. For I know it is because of me that this great storm has come upon you. Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to bring the ship back to land, but they could not, for the sea grew more and more stormy against them. Then they cried out to the Lord, please, O Lord, we pray, do not let us perish on account of this man's life. Do not make us guilty of innocent blood, for you, O Lord, have done as it pleased you. So they picked Jonah up and threw him into the sea, and the sea ceased from its raging. Then the men feared the Lord even more, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord and made vows. But the Lord provided a large fish to swallow up Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. It's a curiosity of the church year that Palm Sunday is also Passion Sunday. Our songs today remind us of the hero's welcome Jesus received when he entered the great city of Jerusalem at the culmination of 3 years of public ministry. And yet he was executed 5 days later. Eyewitness testimony tells us he was not surprised by the fickle affections of the people. He was on a mission, and he succeeded in accomplishing that mission. As we will see today, God's call on our lives can be troubling. Ask Jonah. It can be difficult. It can be unpopular. But as you'll see from the lives of both Jonah and Jesus, God's call always proves worthy of obedience. First, let's look at Jonah, a reluctant agent of God's salvation. We learn from the first verses of the book that Jonah knew that God wanted him to warn the Ninevites that their wickedness had given God ample cause to have his wrath come upon them. But Jonah ran away from the Lord. You know about the boat. To Jonah, just because God wanted something didn't mean that it had to be important to Jonah. You might shake your head and say, what was he thinking? There it is. Jonah couldn't be bothered. We'll delve in further into why in a minute, but start with how Jonah decided that his motives had greater value than God's motives. Oh boy. Doesn't get any better. Jonah is concerned for self. He hears what God wants him to do and says, nope, not today. He goes to the Joppa shipyard and takes the Steamship Authority boat to Tarshish. Jonah was 500 miles from Nineveh. He was 500 miles from Nineveh when he got the call. He looked at the departure board and said, Tarshish, that'll do. Tarshish was 2,000 miles away in the other direction. Thorough, anyway. The way the story is told, Jonah didn't ponder this very much. He quickly got out of town. He comes to the Joppa station counter and says, one ticket to Tarshish, please. Ghosting has become a verb. It means you don't respond to someone's efforts to contact you. Texts, emails, phone calls. You are hiding from them, trying to be as invisible as a supposed ghost. Now, didn't anyone advise Jonah about how effective any attempt to ghost God would be? I promised to look at Jonah's motives for this escape attempt. Prejudice. Jonah didn't want to warn Nineveh because he didn't want those people to repent. And don't judge him wrong. Don't judge him quickly because I could be wrong, but I expect there's a lot of us who are having a hard time praying for the soul of Vladimir Putin. All of a sudden, people want to believe in hell just so that Putin could go there. It was very similar for the Jews in Jonah's time. Nineveh was an important city in the Assyrian Empire. They're the ones who had overrun the northern half of the Holy Land in the 700s BC. Jonah wants nothing to do with mercy. But just as bad as running from God's call is trying to play God, and the two really are quite similar. And judgment is God's business. God's call is not trivial. God does not give up easily. A sailing ship in the wrong direction is no obstacle at all for our God. He controls the winds and the waves. So God uses pagan sailors along with large beasts of the ocean to do his will. And curiously, the pagans aren't quite so pagan by the end of the storm. Together, they make sure that Jonah had that down in the mouth feeling. There are reports, by the way, throughout history that other sailors spent time inside a whale and survived. The one I know best about was a 19th century Englishman who curiously had the last name of Benchley, same as the guy who wrote Jaws. We'll look at Jonah's time in the whale more next week because Jesus himself pointed to it as a prophecy of his own death and resurrection, so it's more an Easter story. Let's just say that once Jonah was in the whale, God could say, well, now that I've got your attention, about Nineveh. Not everyone who witnesses a miracle is motivated to praise God. Take Jonah. God miraculously creates a storm, miraculously provides a whale, both to save Jonah's life and spit him onto the shore of Nineveh. and provides a miraculous change of heart among the hearts of both the king of Nineveh and his subjects. And the result is Jonah is grumpy. Jonah climbs to a vantage point above the city of Nineveh and sulks. Just as he grumpily expected, God forgives the people. And God does not wipe them out. Jonah wanted them all wiped out. God had another perspective. The Bible, the Holy Scriptures that undergird the best in Western civilization, teach us that God is not willing that any should perish. His concern is for the 120,000 souls who make their home in the bustling city of Nineveh. God called Jonah to be his agent of salvation, but Jonah was not only reluctant, he decided he couldn't be bothered. God made it worthwhile for Jonah to change his mind and obey. Now contrast Jonah's response to God's call with Jesus' response. We know from the book of Hebrews, the Psalm 40, verse 8, prophesied about Jesus, "It is written about me in your book, I have come to do your will, O God." While Jonah was a reluctant agent who couldn't be bothered with what would have only cost him a relatively minor change in schedule, Jesus was a willing agent at the ultimate cost. There are two verses that I want to call our attention to in the passage that Ellie read for us. The first is found in verses 26 and 27. Shows our Savior's concern for others. Jesus is on the cross. He is writhing in pain. Impossible to overstate the pain crucifixion causes. But instead of crying out for mercy and relief, he thinks of the loss his mother will feel and the aloneness that the youngest of his disciples will experience. And he fixes both problems with one master stroke. Gesturing toward the apostle John, he says to his mother, "Behold your son," then says to John, "Behold your mother." Jesus knows how important personal relationships are. He loves us. He wants the best for us. Listen, trust, obey his wisdom. And we see the wisdom of our Lord in how he keeps his focus. Many of us, when people speak well of us, fall under the intoxication of that spell. Jesus was not fooled by the acclaim of the crowd. This is Jerusalem. I'm sorry, Hamilton, but to Jesus and the Jews, Jerusalem was the greatest city in the world. And I'm sorry, Sinatra, but if he could make it here. But instead of that, instead of looking for acclaim, Jesus kept his eye on the mission. When he looked at the crowd, he saw lost sheep. That's what God says he saw in Nineveh, too. In chapter 19 of Luke, you can find, as he approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it and said, "If you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace. But now it is hidden from your eyes." Not only was he lamenting the day that they would have to deal with their own guilt for turning on God's son, but many interpreters see there a reference to the coming destruction of the city by Rome in 70 AD. The passage Ellie read has three of the famous seven last words of Jesus on it. The third of which is found in verse 40, where with his last breath, we see focus, how focused on his task Jesus remained to the very end. It's often translated, "It is finished." And that's not wrong, but "it is completed" is probably better. What was it that was completed or finished? Jesus' life or Jesus' task? Like Jonah, Jesus was an agent on a mission. And Jesus' mission uniquely was to be the fulfillment of all the foreshadowing of the Jewish sacrificial system. All the unblemished lamb offered for the forgiveness of sins over the previous 1,400 years had only been placeholders, waiting for the true Lamb of God to take away the sins of the world. When he breathed his last, Jesus had completed his mission and the human race was saved. It is completed. It is accomplished. It is finished. How did Jesus come to be on the cross anyway? How did God superintend human history so that Good Friday happened? The high priest declared Jesus to be a Jonah. To the thinking of the ruling council in Jerusalem, Jesus' popularity with the people rose to dangerous levels when he raised Lazarus from the dead. Too many witnesses, such a stark demonstration of divine power and therefore divine approval, a threat to the plushy security of the high priests. But Jesus was also seen as a threat to the safety of the nation. The Romans allowed the Jews to govern themselves as long as everything remained peaceful. They had delegated power to the religious establishment. From the perspective of the high priest, without them, the country would descend into chaos, without the high priests. And Rome would come in and take away the temple and more. And they weren't entirely wrong. And this was Caiaphas's justification for authorizing the weaponization of the legal system. They had to find a way to get rid of Jesus. Caiaphas said, because it is better for you to have one man die for the people than to have the whole nation destroyed. Where he had said destroyed, he was saying wiped from the earth. Since Exodus, genocide has always circled over Israel's head. To Caiaphas the high priest, Israel was the ship's crew. Keeping Jesus on board was endangering them all. Even though the waters that the calls on both Jonah and Jesus required them to navigate were dangerous and foreboding, we can see that God's call always proves worthy of our obedience. What's he calling you to? Jonah's mission was a city of 120,000 men, women, and children. They were saved. Jesus' mission, the human race was saved. By the resurrection, the destiny of our souls was changed. And I need to tell you this morning that God does not just call prophets and the Messiah. He is searching human hearts for those who will do his will. Is God calling you? Probably. I would submit Jonah's boat ride as evidence that disregarding God's call is hazardous to your health, both your physical health and your spiritual health. And each of us must ask an important question: how can I hear God's call? Oh, I'm too insignificant. Oh, I don't have much to offer. God has a purpose for each life. Do not be frightened by the idea that God has a call for you. Corrie ten Boom, the Dutch Christian, imprisoned for helping Jews escape the Nazis, coined the famous phrase, "The safest place in the world is in the center of God's will." And on the one hand, because we are made in the image of God, we all want our lives to mean something. There's that inner desire. But because we are also impacted and bent by sin in our life, we all have a little Jonah in us too. We're reluctant to rush into obedience. But God's call always proves worthy of obedience. How can you hear it? First of all, know the scriptures and recognize the critical moments, the critical opportunities. There are times when saying, "I'll pray about it," is nothing more than a pious dodge. Has anybody ever asked you to do something and you said, "I'll pray about it," just to get them off your back? Matters of justice and mercy require immediate response. Let's picture Jesus in the boat asleep. The storm comes up. The disciples are scared beyond words. They cry out to the Lord for help. He does not say, "I'll pray about it." You can hear the call of God in the Word of God, and calls for mercy and justice often require immediate response. Second, the call of God involves the spiritual gifts God has given you. Help, administration, mercy, healing, comforting, encouragement, much more. The Revised Standard Version of the Bible translates the beginning of Romans 12:6 as, "Having gifts that differ according to the grace given us, let us use them. Don't let them rot in the shelf." Spiritual gifts are not like the guest towels that your mother put in the bathroom, but the family was supposed to wipe their hands on their pants. Use them. God gives us gifts on purpose for His purpose. Was my mom the only one who did that? The whole of who you are, the wonder of who you are, goes into God's purpose for your life. We have many jobs. Boy, that's fine print, isn't there? I'm coming to it. I'll read it. We have many jobs, but pay special attention to your vocation, God's call on your life. And it might have nothing to do with your paycheck. Frederick Buechner wrote, "Vocation is the place where our deep gladness meets the world's deep need." God's so good at it, He makes us to fit. Both Jonah and Jesus teach us to respond to God's call by trusting God. In both of their stories, we see the deception of self-preservation. We can't save our own lives. We can't guarantee ourselves financial security. Those are God's departments. Jonah and Jesus both knew, one had to learn, that obedience is what matters. It's been a while since I told you about Harry and Nellie Blakesley. They were Christians, members of a congregational church. They loved each other deeply, were saddened when they discovered they weren't getting pregnant and wouldn't. They loved children, and they took a special joy in becoming that house in the neighborhood where all the parents knew they could trust their kids. It was a special neighborhood, in no little part because Harry and Nellie took the love that God placed in their hearts for young people and shared it with all the kids in their neighborhood. And as the years went by and the Blakesleys aged, they began to consider what to do with their estate as they had no legal heirs. Influenced by faithful attention to the scriptures every Sunday, they made a decision that changed the lives of literally hundreds of young adults. They used their entire estate to create a scholarship fund for the young people of their hometown. They followed the call of God as it led them from caring for their own neighborhood in life to caring for their entire town for perpetuity. Not only did their gifts create a significant seed gift for their fund, for that fund, but other folk with greater resources followed their lead and greatly enlarged the fund, using the structure the Blakesleys had put in place, including that the awards committee would include whoever was the pastor of the Blakesleys church. And so for 19 years, I was on the scholarship committee, and we awarded over 1,500 scholarships. What is God calling you to do? Don't be a Jonah. God's call always proves worthy of obedience. Let's pray. God, thank you that you are so good at what you do. Help us not to try to take the wheel out of your hand. Help us to cooperate with your purposes. Give us courage. And help us, Lord, to surrender our resistance that might be based on our own woundedness. You can heal and your purposes are always good. Help us to recognize them, that we not delay in our obedience. And Lord, when we need a radical turnaround in our lives, help us to do it. Have sway in our lives. We want to be those who stand shouting and praising, Hosanna to the King of Kings, not just in good times, but always, knowing that you will give us that glad purpose even for eternity. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. One of the great Palm Sunday hymns of the church, All Glory, Laud, and Honor, 204. On our lips for your goodness, and may we act on it with our lives to the honor and glory of Christ, our once and coming King. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Go in peace. And remember the backyard for the Easter egg hunt.